4 years since Jacinda Ardern's government announced $1.9 billion to improve mental health services, many in the sector say there have been few, if any, improvements. But now, for the first time ever, New Zealand has a dedicated minister for mental health. And Matt Doocey comes to the role after a career in the mental health sector.
Well, in my late teens, I had a bad car accident where I was thrown out of the back windscreen of a car as it flipped end-on end. I actually ended up receiving head injuries. I was in hospital for a number of weeks. And what was really interesting, going back to sort of middle to late 80s, when I was discharged, I had a number of follow-up appointments, but they were all about broken bones. No one ever said to me, you've had a hell of a knock to your head, you should watch out. And so what happened over a course of a number of years, now I know I had things like anxiety and depression, but I struggled to concentrate. I got frustrated very easy. I was getting angry, more and more isolated. Things weren't going well. And everyone said, look, you need to get some support around this. And so I was a young bloke and I sort of refused to do that for a while, but it got to a point where I needed to get some help and I reached out. I always say that was like the light bulb moment. Not only did I get the support that helps me today form a better relationship with my mental health, but I thought to myself, I want to do what that person does. So I trained in counselling psychology, worked in New Zealand, and then I went over for my OE and was lucky enough to work for the NHS and did a number of years with the NHS when I was over there, primarily in the East End, which was a real blessing because it's quite a hard end of the spectrum in East End, but it was a place I got a lot of experience, real rich experience from.
Why does New Zealand need a dedicated minister for mental health?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question, because the first thing I'd say is just getting a job doesn't make a difference. You know, clearly I'll be measured about what I do in this job to make a difference. But look, when we went into opposition, I remember talking to Bill English, our leader at the time, saying, I think it's time we have a standalone mental health minister. Health ministers of all colours are going to get very distracted by physical health. Mental health's always been a poor second cousin to physical health. And I look around the world and some examples of what other jurisdictions had done is create a mental health ministry. I didn't think we need to do that. It would silo mental health more. But there's a role actually that Australia introduced a few years ago, I think it's been quite successful. A standalone mental health minister that not only works within health, but goes into the other government departments. What are we doing about better mental health and education, in corrections, in social development, in housing, and so on and so on.
How many of the actions in your government's 100-day plan were focused on mental health?
Yeah, there's nothing actually in that 100-day plan for any of my portfolios. Mental health, ACC, tourism and youth.
But is mental health not doesn't warrant priority status?
Yeah, well, I think it sends a very clear signal that it is a priority.
Hang on, what sends a clear signal?
Well, when you establish New Zealand's first mental health minister.
But not when you have it in the 100-day plan.
So my first 100 days that I wanted to look at was setting up the role and then going into government, I wanted to look under the hood. I want to know where that $1.9 billion went. I want to know where we spent the $2.5 billion ring-fence funding every year for mental health and addictions. I wanted to work with officials to understand why did the last government have the implementation issues that they did. Mm-hmm. And then also I wanted to understand what is the current capacity and capability of the sector to stand up services and programs to respond to the growing need. So that's what I've been doing in the first 100 days.
Let's start with some real basics then. What publicly funded mental health services should New Zealanders expect under your government?
Yeah, well, I think what we should have is a primary mental health care system that people should be able to access in pretty much real time, in a matter of a week. And then followed from that, those who need a specialist service, they should be able to access that within a number of weeks as well. What I also think we need to do though, which is the real crux of the issue in New Zealand, we have some real constraints about our publicly funded mental health system. Mm. I think we need to look about how we get some of that money out of Wellington into the grassroots organisations who are already delivering, and when I visited them, they tell me they're primed for growth. They've got a workforce separate to the publicly funded mental health system.
Right.
And we can offset some of that demand by utilising our NGO and community sector.
So in essence, we would have a community-level support, then a primary-level support, and an acute or specialist-level support.
Very much so.
So should we as New Zealanders expect the same level of services for mental health as we do for physical health?
Of course. And this has been part of the problem, that mental health has been the poor second cousin to physical health. And I'll tell you what, the addiction sector will tell you they've been a poor cousin to mental health as well. We've got to elevate that, because look what happens at the moment around mental health crisis call-outs. If you have a physical health crisis, you call 111, you get a health response. When you call 111 with a mental health crisis, you get a criminal justice response. So actually, we've got to respond differently to mental health, ensuring we get people a mental health response. And unfortunately, that has been lacking.
Are you concerned that police aren't going to be responding to those calls?
Well, what I can say is I'm thankful for the police, to the level of response they give. We don't want to end up like in the UK, where the Metropolitan Police have issued an instruction that very soon they won't be going out to mental health
but
crisis
But police have
call-outs.
Said they are going to be responding to those calls less than in the past. That's one of their new focuses.
And that's a piece of work that we have got at the moment, to look at what I call the crisis pathway. What are we doing within the dispatch centre? I've said quite openly, maybe it's a time we have a fourth option. You call up, you get ambulance, police, fire or mental health. I think we need to triage better there. And then based on the level of risk to that person and people around them, is it a police and a mental health response? Maybe it's a mental health response, and then where do we take them? Is it solely the ED, or Australia's doing a lot better in respite centres in the community? Something we also need to do in New Zealand, I think, Jack, is not all distress is a mental illness. So some of those calls for mental distress is not about a mental illness either. So we need to think about how we respond to distress in New Zealand as well.
I'll talk about that distinction a little bit more in a moment. Workforce shortages are massive,
yes,
as you know, across the mental health sector. We have a shortage of nurses, a shortage of psychiatrists, and of course of psychologists as well. In fact, by some estimates, we are 1,000 psychologists short in New Zealand. In your election manifesto, you promised to double the number of clinical psychologists being trained in New Zealand to 80 a year.
Yeah.
How many were trained last year?
I think we're about 50 or 60. What's really concerning to me at the moment, Jack, is that I'm trying to understand the workforce modelling, and it'd be fair to say it's not actually there yet. But something I was able to get in the last couple of weeks is that the data is showing we are starting to move up to 70 or 80 psychologists under the new clinical internship hub model.
I mean, the Ministry of Health made it clear that the 80 that you want to see being trained were trained last year.
Yeah.
So you said you wanted to double the number of clinical psychologists being trained from 40 to 80.
Yeah.
They say we're already at 80.
Yeah, but the intent was to double the amount of psychologists through internship hubs. But I think the real point here, Jack, is that the data I've had recently, the modelling, has said we need to train 350 psychologists a year to meet the vacancy rates of Health New Zealand. Now, at the moment, we are only training up to 80. So my point being is that, yes, we can grow the clinical internship placements, which we will do, but actually, we've actually got to do things differently.
Number of internship placements, sorry to interrupt you, has more than quadrupled since 2019 at the moment.
Yes.
So in terms of actual students, clinical psychology students in final year, what will we expect under your government? Are you going to double it from 80 where it's at the moment to 160?
Well, I'll tell you what we're looking at the moment is there's about 500 to 600 people who graduate at an undergraduate psychology level. Now, when they don't get one of those 50 or 80 psychology internship placements, they disappear. What I want to know is that whether we can establish, as the UK has done, a new registered pathway for assistant psychologists that we can then use that 500 to 600 people who graduate.
Right.
I've already visited a couple of universities. It's been a positive conversation. So, yep, I want to grow the number of clinical internship placements, but I'll be very clear, if the modelling I've received shows we need 350 a year, I think we need to do different pathways as well.
So how many will you fund? This is from Health New Zealand. Further increases to the psychology workforce will require university programs to significantly increase their intake and an associated funding increase.
Yes. So there are going to be announcements I'm going to be making soon, what we are going to be doing in the workforce, specifically psychology. But let's be very clear, as the Auditor General in his report announced only 2 weeks ago, said we are desperately in the need of a workforce plan. We don't have a workforce plan for mental health.
You mentioned your interest in mental health, if you like, was sparked in the wake of a car accident, which contributed to anxiety and depression. Would seeing a psychologist for that be covered now under the current system?
Probably not. Probably what you would get covered by now is going to an access and choice program within the GP.
But that would be something like that would be covered under ACC, except that ACC doesn't cover mental health, right?
Yeah, there is the issue around that. But I just want to be very clear about my point is we're not, everyone who has some mental distress doesn't need to see a psychologist and a psychiatrist. There is a range of workforce out there, and what also gets left out is our lived experience peer support workforce as well.
You said at the start of this interview that mental health should be treated like physical health. So, should ACC cover mental health care?
Well, I think that's an option we can explore.
Should it? What's your position as Minister?
Yeah, well, I'm seeking advice on that.
You're seeking advice on whether ACC should cover mental health support?
Well, I'm more specific seeking advice on the area around first responders and the issue for them around being exposed to multiple events.
So I'm asking about ACC though, someone who experiences a traumatic event, should they be supported for mental health support after that event?
I'm keen to explore that, Jack. I'm new in role, I'm new as the ACC
But you have been the opposition spokesperson for 6 years.
No, hold on. I wasn't the opposition spokesperson for ACC.
For mental health you were though.
Let's be very clear about that as well.
For mental health. Why is I Am Hope exempt from the usual service procurement processes? I think we all agree Mike King does an amazing job, and I'm not disputing the services they provide, but why should that one organisation be exempt from those regular processes?
Yeah, so in the coalition agreement, we agreed to fund I Am Hope, or Gumboot, Friday by $6 million. One of the reasons we decided to do that is the Gumboot Friday platform has over 400 mental health professionals on that platform. They can take referrals for young people and be seen within 48 hours. Part of what this government's going to do is take some of the demand away from the public mental health system and ask the NGO and community service to pick that up. Now, not only do I think by giving them $6 million, they'll be able to obviously increase the number of young people they'll be seen, I'm very interested for those young people who are on a wait list for specialist services, whether some of those young people can be seen by Gumboot Friday to keep stable in that time. I was talking to my counterpart in Australia yesterday afternoon, Minister Emma McBride, and she's the mental health minister at a federal level. They have a similar issue about wait times for specialist youth mental health services, and are looking at how the community and NGO sector can complement that, and that's what we're doing by funding Gumboot Friday.
So I'm not disputing the work that Gumboot Friday does. Again, I think everyone can see it does some really, really valuable and important work. But it doesn't answer my question. Why should it be exempt from regular procurement processes?
Well, I'm not sure it is exempt.
What other mental health service providers are you funding through the coalition agreement that aren't going through another procurement process?
As an example, what happened under the last government,
What about your government?
I know, and I'll come back to that, but I would use an example of the Picky pilot. That was directly funded by the last government as well, for specifically the Wellington region.
And is that good policy making to pick and choose which organisations won't be subject to regular procurement?
Yeah, we've got the funding to Gumboot Friday.
Yeah, I understand that. Is that good policy to just pick and choose which organisations get the funding?
Well, I don't think anyone would disagree about funding Gumboot Friday and the response that they
can make. But they might disagree about the process,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, but that was a decision we made in the coalition agreement. The second thing I'd say.
So again, I'm asking if it's good policy just to pick and choose which organisations are exempt from regular procurement.
Well, I think that if you were saying is good policy getting money to the front line of an organisation...
That's not the question, though, Minister. Yeah. The question is it good policy to pick and choose which organisations don't have to go through regular procurement?
But also, you're forgetting that we announced the Mental Health Innovation Fund, Jack.
Minister, can you just answer that one question? Is it good policy to pick and choose, for any government, which organisations are exempt from regular procurement processes?
Well, if it's a good policy to get $6 million to Gumboot Friday, I'll say yes.
The suicide rate for Māori men between the ages of 15 and 24 is more than two times higher than non-Māori of the same age group. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, well, that concerns me. And one of the most difficult part of the jobs is I meet a lot of people who have either attempted suicide themselves or have been bereaved by suicide. And I think that we're going to have to clearly do a lot better in that space. When you look about Māori and the rate versus non-Māori, I think it's about 18 per 100,000 that commit suicide in New Zealand to a Māori. Non-Māori are about 10 per 100,000.
Why do you think that
is? Well, I think Māori are overrepresented in those statistics. I think through things like poverty, discrimination, stigma, I'd even go as far as to say colonisation as well. And I think we have to be open to actually understanding that the experiences Māori experience and the impacts that has clearly on our suicide rates.
So what agency is responsible for overseeing the response to Māori suicide?
Well, at the moment we've got the Suicide Prevention Office, and I must say it's a sensitive area, but actually from the outside looking in, I've been quite disappointed with the Suicide Prevention Office. I think it hasn't had the leadership that it should have had. I don't think it's got the profile of actually directing what it needs to do. The Suicide Prevention Action Plan is up for review this year after 5 years, and I want to look at that. I want to understand the workforce issues within our suicide prevention work. Mm. But I also want to understand, again, how we can use our NGO and community sector, because I'll give you a good example. Mm. Most people will connect with this example. The construction sector has the highest suicide rate out of any sector. Most people will know what mates in construction is. Mm. And that's how we will get that message out there.
What about the Māori Health Authority? It's expanded Māori suicide prevention from 9 providers to 23 providers nationwide.
Yes.
So what official advice have you had about the impact of scrapping the Māori Health Authority on Māori suicide rates?
So the Suicide Prevention Office was removed from the Ministry of Health, or shifted into the Māori Health Authority. I haven't got any advice under that, other than to say I am a big supporter of by Māori for Māori services. Mm. I think it is about in suicide prevention devolution, local solutions for local needs.
So what advice have you had then about the impact of scrapping the Māori Health Authority, which is commissioning all of those services and is commissioning a lot in the suicide space?
But I think you're conflating two issues, Jack.
On Māori suicide.
The scrapping of the bureaucracy of the Māori Health Authority is different than the services. We are putting those services back inside one system, the health system.
And so those services will continue to be funded?
Yes, very much so.
All 23?
And I tell you what, we actually need to do more. Mm. Because when I meet iwi, and I was recently meeting Ngāti Hine up in Waitangi when I was up there, they talk of stories when the CAT teams are called for people and the CAT team isn't able to go out. And the iwi takes it upon themselves and said, actually, we will go out. Mm. And they go out and see their people. That is what mental health is about. There'll be a lot of range of views about the centralisation approach of the health reforms. Mm. You could argue a hip replacement in Christchurch is the same as a hip replacement in Wellington. Mental health is completely different. Yeah. It's actually got to be localised. How we respond to suicide prevention where I am today in North Canterbury, for middle-aged male dairy farmers, will potentially be very different than young Māori in South Auckland. And so that's why this role is about bringing that focus and that detail to those issues.
Mental health, ACC, youth and tourism. As a first-time minister, Matt Doocey is juggling a lot of varied portfolios. And for the last part of our interview, I started by asking about drug harm and addiction.
What drug causes the most harm in New Zealand?
I'd have to say alcohol. If you would call that a drug, I would. Obviously, smoking.
Certainly a drug.
As well.
Yeah. So do you support greater restrictions on alcohol advertising and sponsorship?
Well, I think, to be honest, I haven't really looked at it that much in detail. I think whether...
I mean, addiction is a massive part of mental health.
Yeah, but I think sometimes the debate around alcohol or cannabis can get a bit binary about whether it's liberalised or the prohibition. The reality is, whatever the regime is, people will still have problems with that substance. I was able to
when was the last time you saw an ad for cannabis on television?
Yeah, well, I mean, that's obvious why we don't have an ad for cannabis.
That's a really important point, though, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, the ministerial forum established under the previous national government was explicit in its advice. The number one policy they said we could introduce to reduce alcohol harm in New Zealand would be to introduce greater restrictions on sponsorship and advertising. And you, as the Minister for Mental Health, haven't given it much thought?
Well, no, because A, that is not my decision, and B, I would say it's more about education. Yeah, but Jack, you're asking me the question, and what I'm saying to you is that you can go through the regime, I accept that, my own experience in working in alcohol and drug services, but actually whatever the regime is, you are going to have a group of people who have problematic use. For me, that is about education, that's about building the skills within people, and the support services for those who need to reach out as well.
We talked at the start of this interview about the difference between mental distress and mental disorders.
Yes.
Should people with mental disorders be in prison?
Well, that's a very good question, and I suppose, has someone committed a crime that results in them going to prison? The answer is yes.
And if their mental disorder is a contributing factor in that crime, should they be in prison?
Yeah, well, I think that's a very interesting thing to explore. You'd ask yourself at the moment, are we screening or assessing people in prison? I would say not enough. And we've got to understand how we understand the mental health issues this person has and how it contributes to the offending. Mm. So if you are saying the point of prison is to A, keep the public safe, but also use that opportunity to rehabilitate people, then yes, we should have good mental health and addiction services in there.
Can you tell us how your vision for tourism in New Zealand differs from the current reality?
From the current reality? Yeah. Well, that's an interesting question. I mean, what I would say to you is that it was very clear under Nicola Willis's announcement last year when she opened up the books, we've got years of deficits ahead of us. So quite rightly, any government needs to cut its cloth, and that's what we're doing, like any family and business has done in the last few years. Mm. The other side of that equation is how do we then grow the economy? Tourism and hospitality is one of our biggest export earners. So what we want to do is grow tourism. And I'm really excited about the figures that were announced yesterday. It showed that tourism had bounced back to our second biggest export earner. The data to March 2023 showed that tourism expenditure was about $37 billion, only about $4 billion shy of the $41 billion it was at pre-COVID. So it shows that the tourists are coming back. And as I travel around the country as a new tourism and hospitality minister, it's really exciting, and I love meeting all the colourful characters, our tourism operators, and they're loving the ability to showcase New Zealand to our international visitors.
So back to my question, how would your vision for tourism in New Zealand change things? What would you do differently?
Well, at the moment, what we want to do is grow tourism. We want to...
How much bigger should it be, do you think?
Well, that's not for me to say. I mean,
could it be New Zealand's largest export industry again?
Well, potentially. But when I say I want to grow the value of tourism, I want to do it with social licence. I want communities to be part of that discussion. I'm really encouraged at the moment of the structure we have in New Zealand. We have our regional tourism organisations who put together what's called destination management plans. That's part of communities deciding, do they want tourism? What attractions do they have to offer? And what levels do they want coming in? So look, it's not for me, out of the beehive, to tell areas what they want to do in tourism, other than I think a government's role is to create the settings that tourism operators can grow, invest another dollar, employ another person, and then get out of their way so they can go on and do what they need to do.
So is it good for productivity, for growing wage rises, that kind of thing?
Yeah, when you look at hospitality and tourism, it's a way of bringing jobs into some of the smaller rural towns.
But is it good for productivity?
And our regionals as well, when you think about it, it is about jobs and incomes there, Jack. And that's what tourism can do. It can be a real economic catalyst for rural and regional New Zealand.
MB is of the view that unmanaged tourism growth over the medium to long term is unlikely to tackle New Zealand's broader economic challenges, including productivity and lifting per capita incomes.
Yeah,
that's from your briefing as the new
minister. I know, but I'm slightly pushed back on that, Jack. What I'm actually seeing from our tourist operators, and I think really when you look at the value of tourism to our GDP, the latest stats showed about $3.7 billion. I think we should be patting our tourism operators on the back and thanking them for being part of our economic recovery. And what they're telling me is that they are looking at their products now, at their services, and looking at higher value of what they are achieving with the international visitors. I think that will drive productivity, and I think that should be encouraged. And when you look at tourism, it's largely private capital. We should be creating the settings that our tourist operators can go on and flourish, and that's what I think the role of government is.